We're going to go ahead and get started. Can you hear me now? We're going to go ahead and get started. The IT fellow is not here yet. But we can still vote. I can still talk real loud with this microphone. If you need a microphone, the only thing, our podium mic is out. So we are waiting on Chris to arrive.
All rise. Yes. This Washington County Board of County Commissioners, now in session, pursuant to adjournment. Honorable Chairman Greg Mattingly presiding, remain standing and come to order.
Thank you, Sheriff. First order of business this evening is the prayer led by Commissioner Krieger, the pledge led by Commissioner Owen.
For the Lord of Prayer, which we play, Father God, we've got this together this evening to deliberate the business and the welfare of our county. We ask for your guidance and your direction. We ask for wisdom, knowledge, and discernment. We ask for your continued blessing for those of us who are not participating in our last meeting as a commissioner. And Father God, we ask for your blessing and your guidance on those newly elected commissioners who will take office on September 1st. We also ask your blessing on our newly elected county officials, just as you have blessed those who have served in the past. And finally, Father, we ask your blessing on our country. We just fervently pray you will lead our country back to you. In Christ's name we bless. Amen.
Amen.
The honor of America.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Go ahead and indicate your presence here this evening, slating the yes button. Clerk, we have 24 present. Do you have a quorum? Next item is approval of the agenda.
Move for approval.
Question.
Commissioner.
I have a question. If this is the proper time, I'm moving something on the agenda for the on resolution number 180814 on page 73. That's under the employee comp.
Were you going to second?
Yes, but I thought.
I'll second.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Go ahead, Commissioner Council.
But just on page 73, that resolution did not come through our committee, it went through the budget committee. And I just want to see if we can move that underneath the budget committee.
And what resolution number was that?
That was 180814.
180814?
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
To move that resolution under the budget committee report?
Yes, please.
Also, the highway superintendent, as you see, resolution 180830 on the table this evening is handed out. Has requested that this money be moved for your consideration this evening. Be added to the agenda. Just to move $325,000 from the state aid program to the asphalt plant operations. I think Mr. Beaton is here tonight to ask any questions. This would require us to suspend the rule if we did have a motion to place this item on the agenda.
I so move.
Second.
Let's go ahead and take care of that change with the motion in a second. Is there any other changes to the agenda? Just do that under the section. So do we have any other changes to the agenda to consider? Seeing none. All in favor of the approving the agenda as amended, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed. All right, let's go back and consider resolution 180830 to add to the agenda. We'll have to consider that. We'll have to suspend the rule. We have a motion to suspend the rule.
I'll move. Second.
Motion made by Commissioner Oldham, seconded by Commissioner Hodge. Suspend the rule for consideration to consider resolution 180830. Discussion?
Question?
All those in favor of suspending the rule to consider this resolution signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, like sign. The rule is suspended. I have a motion to add this resolution to the agenda.
So moved.
Second. Motion made by Commissioner McGuire, seconded by Commissioner Carriger. Add resolution 180830 to the agenda. Discussion?
Question
been called. All in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, like sign. The motion passes and we'll add the resolution to tonight's agenda. We do not have any public comments that have been signed up this evening. However, we do need to move into public hearing to consider two rezonings. The first rezoning is a rezoning of Jackie Lowell Denny and Joni Cole Carroll Denny, the 12th Civil District, requesting R2 low density residential to R1 low density residential. Is there anyone here to speak in favor of this request this evening? Is there anyone here to speak in opposition to? Seeing none. Next rezoning is Googs Little and Associates, Shirley Crossan and Ellen Jamerson Trust. It's 12th Civil District, A1 General Agricultural District, the R1 low density district, and the PRD2 plant district. Is there anyone here to speak in favor of this request? Is there anyone here to speak in opposition to? Seeing none, we'll close the public hearing and convene in a regular session. Charles, if you want to come forward, give us the staff recommendation on these two rezonings.
Our first item is a zoning map amendment, which is really more of a housekeeping item. This property is located on Gray Station Road and was de-annexed by Johnson City on July 5th. But now that it's outside the city limits, the zoning authority returns to the county. We are recommending the R1 zoning classification. It's in keeping with the area and with the property zoning prior to annexation. The next item is a rezoning request, approximately 61 acres in Lookout off Cedar Creek Road in Gray. They extend up the hill to Dove Lane, which is located off Kingsmore Highway. The land is currently vacant, and the purpose of the rezoning is to accommodate a residential development that would be consisting of single-family lots and patio homes. Johnson City has advised that water and sewer are available and adequate for the proposed residential use. And the planning commission recommended approval of both of these items on their August meeting. May I answer any questions?
Thank you. You find the minutes of the planning commission in your packet. The next item is to consider two resolutions. Resolutions 180801 is a resolution rezoning tax map in the 12 Silver District presently owned by Jack and Long Diddy and Joey Carroll Diddy. Motion made to approve the resolution by Commissioner Davenport, seconded by Commissioner Borden. Discussion? Question's been called. Madam Clerk, if you'll switch us to the voting screen, please. Go ahead and cast your vote and mark it in. Yes, one absent. Resolution passes. Next resolution, resolution 180802, the resolution rezoning a parcel in the 12th Civil District, presently owned by George Gooch, a little and associates, Shirley Carlson, and Ellen Jamerson Trust. Is that a motion?
Second.
Motion made by Commissioner Story, seconded by Commissioner Markey to approve the resolution. Discussion? Question's been called. Madam Clerk, if you'll switch us to the voting screen. Go ahead and cast your vote and mark it in. Madam Clerk, if you'll announce the vote. Yes, sir, but one absent. Resolution passes. Next item is we have several proclamations. Mayor Eldridge, you come forward for the proclamations.
Whereas suicide is one of the most disruptive and tragic events a family and a community can experience, with more than 1,000 lives lost in Tennessee each year and an estimated 8 to 25 attempted suicides for each suicide death. And whereas suicide is the 10th leading cause of all deaths in Tennessee and the second leading cause of death among people from the age of 10 to 24. And whereas 3 lives a day are lost to suicide in Tennessee, which means we lose 21 Tennesseans each week and 84 people per month. And whereas Tennessee veterans, active duty military personnel, and National Guardsmen face a disproportionate risk as compared to the general declares suicide prevention as a state priority. And the legislature, in partnership with the Tennessee Suicide Prevention Network, implements the Tennessee Strategy for Suicide Prevention based on the National Strategy for Suicide Prevention. And whereas Tennessee is a national leader in the effort to prevent suicide, being one of the first states to develop a suicide prevention and evaluation plan covering the lifespan. And whereas the governor of Tennessee has appointed the Suicide Prevention Network Advisory Council to coordinate the implementation of Tennessee Strategy for Suicide Prevention. And whereas TSPN is a grassroots collaboration of Tennesseans and organizations working to eliminate the stigma of suicide, educate the community about warning signs of suicide, and ultimately reduce the rate of suicide in our state. And whereas the Tennessee Suicide Prevention Network is committed to excellence in suicide prevention, intervention, and postvention. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Board of County Commissioners of Washington County and I, Daniel J. Eldridge, County Mayor, September 2018 is hereby proclaimed to be Suicide Prevention Awareness Month in Washington County, and do urge all citizens to work to prevent suicide and to raise awareness and tolerance around all people affected by this tragedy.
Thank you, Mayor. We have a motion.
Move for approval.
Motion made by Commissioner Light and seconded by Commissioner Gordon to approve the resolution for proclamation. Discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. Proclamation passes.
Thank you. Yes, I just want to thank you all for your support, Mayor Eldridge, and everyone on the commission. It means a lot to have your support, and we have been fortunate to have that for many years. We do have a special event coming up on September 22nd at the VA. On that Saturday morning from 9 to 12, we are going to have a Survivors of Suicide Walk, and we encourage anyone in our community that has lost a loved one to suicide to please come out that day and support this event. So thank you all so much. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, ladies. Daniel Boone, Little League Girls Softball Team. Come on down. Services in the community. It furnishes physical facilities, volunteer services, and resources to much success during the 2018 softball season. And whereas the team has a group of 9 girls who have played together since they were 7 years old and had many winning seasons, and have hoped to play one day for the Daniel Boone High School softball program. The team's expectation for this year was to get to Warner Robins towards the District 5. The Daniel Boone Little League girls softball team worked hard and won the state tournament, which made them eligible to enter the Southeast tournament at Warner Robins. Whereas upon their arriving at the Southeast tournament, the Daniel Boone Little League girls softball team said, "Why not us? Why can't we do this?" So they decided to play, taking that motto to heart. Whereas upon the return to grade, a wave of support and raising of funds from the great community in Washington County made the trip a reality for the girls, coaches, and families. Only 4 of the 11 players and 3 coaches had even flown before. The Daniel Boone Little League girls softball team left on August 6th on a charter bus to Charlotte, North Carolina, to catch the plane taking them to Portland, Oregon. They arrived wearing their Southeast champion shirts with the unofficial motto, "Why not us?" And whereas Little League Girls Softball World Series team included Thule, Canada Victoria, British Columbia, West Kirkland, Washington, East Tuckahannock, Pennsylvania, Europe, Africa, Prague, Czech Republic, Southeast, which is Great Tennessee. Pool B was Asia Pacific, and District 4 was Lake Oswego, Oregon, Southwest River Ridge, Louisiana. And you don't have to spell it this way. Spell all these places. And whereas the Daniel Boone Little League softball team played 4 games in Pool Play. They lost the first 2 games to Kirkland, Washington, 9-5, Leyritz, Canada, 7-2, but bounced back, beating Tuckahannock, Pennsylvania, 1-0, and Prague, Czech Republic, 15-0. Wow. In the brackets quarterfinal round, the team lost to East Bank of River Ridge, 9-2. And be it resolved by the Board of County Commissioners of Washington County, Tennessee, and I, Daniel J. Eldridge, County Mayor, that we give public recognition and do honor the 2018 Daniel Boone Little League softball team, manager, and assistant coaches for their achievements and contributions to Washington County.
All those in favor of the proclamation signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, like sign. Proclamation passes.
Late edition here was Kaylee Musselman. You guys, anybody that followed it on TV probably saw, but we just wanted to say thanks for the support. We enjoyed it. They're a great group of girls. And to fly 2,200 miles across the country, it was a magical experience. So just thanks for it. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Officially began fundraising campaign, changing lives and making a difference in our community as a kickoff event on August 23rd. Be it resolved by the Board of County Commissioners of Washington County, and I, Daniel J. Eldridge, County Mayor, August 23rd, 2018 is hereby proclaimed to be United Way of Washington County, Tennessee, local kickoff day in Washington County, and urge residents to participate in the fundraising campaign in support of United Way and its partners and programs, thereby making ours a more caring and compassionate community where we all give, advocate, volunteer, live united.
Thank you, Mayor. We have a motion to the proclamation.
Move for approval.
Motion made by Commissioner Boring, second by Commissioner Carrier, to approve the rest of the proclamation. Discussion. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, like sign. Proclamation passes.
Chair, a little bit.
So last year alone, almost 50% of the residents in Washington County, Tennessee, received assistance through our partner agency programs, which would not have been possible without the help of United Way. And as you all know, as county commissioners, without United Way, there would be a lot of needs in the community that the taxpayers' dollars would have to address. So we are looking to continue to change lives and make an even bigger difference in our community with the new model of United Way. We're accepting applications for new agency programs for the first time in 13 years. And we also have developed our own programming, which is VELO, our virtual volunteer reading program that we're piloting this year in 10 second grade classrooms in those school systems. So thank you all for your past support, but please continue to support us, whether giving, advocating, or volunteering, so we can continue to change lives and make a difference in the community.
If you wonder why I'm up here, I am the campaign chair this year. That's why I'm standing here, just not because I'm like president. But I did put on your desk right here, you'll notice one thing. United Way is just not Johnson City or Jonesboro. It is a true Washington County organization. If you look on there, we broke it down by how we assist people in Washington County, how United Way assists people in Jonesboro, how they assist people in Johnson City. So please, we hope for your support in any way you can. So thank you so much.
The next proclamation originated with the Public Records Commission, and it's a thank you in a way to our chairman for the last 8 years. And I asked Mayor Elkins if he would mind, on behalf of the Records Commission, if I was allowed to read the proclamation. And he was kindly let me do that. So, proclamation. In recognition of Dr. Samuel Harold Humphreys for his public service to the citizens of Washington County, Tennessee. Whereas Dr. Sam Humphreys is a retired educator, charity business owner, justice of the peace, and has served 6 terms representing District 2 as a member of the Washington County Board of Commissioners. And whereas Dr. Sam Humphreys has served as chairman of the Washington County Public Records Commission for the past 8 years, and as chairman provided leadership in creating the Department of Records Management and Archives, Reserve and Management, the Historic Public Records of Washington County. And whereas Dr. Humphreys attended Science Hill High School, where he played football and ran track, achieving a state distance record, attended the University of South Carolina on a 4-year football scholarship, attended graduate school at East Tennessee State University, earned a doctorate from Virginia Tech, a doctorate of letters from Oxford Graduate School, and attended one summer at Harvard University for an administrative symposium. And whereas Dr. Humphreys has been a teacher and coach at Marshtown, Tennessee, teacher, coach, principal, and superintendent of Washington County Schools, taught at East Tennessee State University College of Education for 15 years, and was director of the university school there, where he was chosen principal of the year in 1993, and served as assistant vice president at ETSU's College of Medicine. And whereas Dr. Humphreys was first elected as a Washington County Commissioner in 1968, and served on the County Farm Committee, Airport Authority, and Archives Committee. While on the County Farm Committee, Dr. Humphreys helped many brought concerns and problems to them. And at three different times, he helped the farm pull calves while visiting the county farm. And whereas Dr. Humphrey's family is his pride and joy, Dr. Humphrey's and his wife Joan have been married for over 50 years. They have two children, Laura, Robin, and Seth, grandson Isaac, and a granddaughter due in September. Dr. Humphrey's and Joan have traveled to 48 states, 10 foreign countries, and hope to travel more in the future. And whereas Dr. Humphrey's and Joan have restored four old log cabins, including the one in which they live, the Isaac Hammer House, which was built in 1793 and is on the National Register of Historic Places. Dr. Humphrey's and his wife, Joan, moved to Christopher Taylor House and rebuilt in Jonesboro in 1972 and restored the young cabin at Rocky Mount. Dr. Humphrey's and Joan owned the Range House on East Oakland, where they have hosted weddings for many years, and as Justice of the Peace, Dr. Humphrey's has performed numerous wedding ceremonies. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Board of County Commissioners of Washington County, Tennessee, and County Mayor Daniel J. Eldridge, that we give public recognition and due honor Dr. Samuel Merrill Humphrey's for his 40-plus years of public service to the citizens of Washington County, Tennessee.
Move approval.
Motion made. Motion made by Commissioner Light, seconded by Commissioner Chase to approve the proclamation. Discussion. All those in favor of the proclamation signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. Proclamation passes. Consider the minutes from the July 23rd regular meeting of the Board of County Commissioners.
Move approval.
Motion made by Commissioner Chase, seconded by Commissioner Story to approve the minutes. Discussion.
Question.
Call. All those in favor of approving the minutes, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Like sign. Except. All right, we have a lot of election appointments and nominations. First resolution is 180803. It's a resolution confirming the county mayor's appointment to the Emergency Communications District 911 Board of Directors.
So moved.
Motion made by Commissioner Hodge, seconded by Commissioner Carriger. Approve the resolution. Discussion.
Question.
Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Tesser.
Mr. Chairman, there's a lot of these on here tonight, and I was wondering if for each one, if you could quickly tell us what the vacancy is. Is it?
Yes.
Are the terms expiring, or people,
yes,
people resigning, or, and then also, because the way the word is, some of them say they're confirmations of the mayor's appointments, but other ones don't say that. So I guess I'd like a little clarification on each one in terms of if it's confirming an appointment from somebody else or if it's actually the commission's appointment.
Yes, absolutely. Yes. This in particular one is a vacancy on the 94 on the Board of Directors where I served. I had to resign, so that created a vacancy. This is the mayor's appointment, and all we are doing this evening is affirming his appointment. Is there further questions? Madam Clerk, if you'll switch us to the voting screen. Go ahead and cast your vote. Lock it in. Madam Clerk, if you'll announce the vote. 23 yes. Abstain, we'll have a suit. Resolution passes. Next resolution is Resolution 180804. It's a resolution confirming the county mayor's appointments to the Washington County Regional Planning Commission.
Second.
Motion made by Commissioner Davenport, seconded by Commissioner Larkin. On this one, I'll have to confer with the mayor. This is the mayor's appointments, and we will just be confirming that is that correct or soon.
Two county commissioners that we have going off, we are replacing them because we actually have a planning commission meeting next week. So trying to keep the business going and make those appointments prior to the meeting next week.
Any further questions? Seeing none. Madam Clerk, if you'll switch us to the voting screen, please. Go ahead and cast your vote. Mark it in. Vote 23 yes, 1 abstain, 1 absent. Resolution passes. Next resolution is Resolution 180805. Is a resolution appointing a member for the Washington County Johnson City Animal Control Center Board of Directors. Nominations.
It's not a commissioner position.
There's no, it's not. The bylaws call for it to be a county executive and a Washington County citizen.
Mr. Chairman, I currently serve on that committee right now. I think my term expires in December, if that's correct. I think December, my term expires in December. Yeah. I think it's obviously.
Your term doesn't expire until December?
Yes. But there's two positions. I'm sorry, there's two positions. One's a mayor's appointment, one's a county commission appointment.
Okay. Okay,
so there's still a vacancy right now.
Can somebody explain what animal control does? Because the reason I'm asking is, it looks like a man that's sitting next to me in Murphy's first said, I'm on the animal control board, and I go around and pick up dead animals.
I thought
McAllister could offer you a great explanation.
Trust me, you will not be picking up any dead animals. We have animal control officers. The city and county are required to do animal control in Washington County. To do that, we have a joint venture between the city and the county called the Animal Control Board, and that's what this is. And what your responsibility is to make sure the animal shelter and the animal control is done within Washington County and is picking up animals, make sure it's done properly, the health and welfare of animals within Washington County. That's the gist of it, what the Animal Control Board does. Make sure it's funded properly.
Commissioner McAllister, when do you all meet again?
We meet the first Tuesday of every month. There's seven members currently.
So that will be next Tuesday, correct?
Yes. If you wanted, Mayor, we could possibly hold this until next month if someone make a nomination, because they'd still have a quorum at the board.
So there's two members, one of them is the mayor, or Errol designee, and the other is a citizen, and so probably need to change the mayor.
Can we just defer this maybe to next month and have the new mayor look at that decision?
I think that'd be a good idea.
Motion made by Commissioner Lott, seconded by Commissioner Ford. Discussion. All in favor of that motion, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, like sign. Motion's made, and we'll continue that on until next month's agenda. Next resolution is Resolution 180806. Is a resolution appointing a member to the Washington County Health Council. Motion made by Mr. Hensley, seconded by the Commissioner Council. Mr. Seeley, will you tell us about the Health Council? Well, you know more than I do.
The Health Council's bylaws state that the Washington County Health Council will exist within the boundaries of Washington County and it is the Assistant Department of Health Advisory Department regarding health problems of Washington County. It assists the department in its responsibility to undertake community diagnosis. The council promotes the prevention of premature death, disability, and illness by developing a Washington County Community Health Plan for recommendation to the department.
Is this the mayor's appointment, Tom? Or is
it is a recommendation to the director of the health plan. Again, historically, it's been in conjunction with the director and the mayor to make that recommendation.
Thank you. All right. Any discussion? Or any further questions? Madam Clerk, if you'll switch us to the voting screen, please cast your vote, lock it in. Madam Clerk, if you'll announce the vote, 24 yes, 0 no, we'll ask the resolution passes. Next resolution is Resolution 180808. It's a resolution appointing members to the Board of Commissioners. The Tri-Cities Airport Authority.
So moved.
Motion made by Commissioner Wolf, seconded by Commissioner Hodge to approve the resolution. These positions are normally customarily the mayor does fill in one of these positions customarily. Tom, can you tell us a little bit more about
these three members are appointed by the county. It's historically the way the resolution has been prepared. There has been a slate of three divided to the commission. But these are the commissions
further questions? Commissioner Ford?
I'd like to ask, is this normally appointed by, like, you mayor, or would it be by Joe, or is this not normally done in clerical term?
I think in this case, it's just recognizing that my term is up, I don't care to serve again. Typically, the mayor has served. I think Joe has said that he's not interested in serving on it. So, again, it goes back to the same situation with the planning commission, just trying to make the appointments so that Washington County's vacancies are filled before the next meeting.
Commissioner Tester?
So, you said your term was up?
Right.
My term is up at the end of this month.
Are the other two terms up this month also?
Yes.
Well, I think that the ones that have been nominated are very well qualified to serve on the airport authority, and I believe that we're accepting.
We have a motion and second on the floor. I think the discussion was just for clarification, or if there was any further discussion.
All questions.
Questions will come. Madam Clerk, if you'll switch us to the voting screen. Go ahead and cast your vote and lock it in. Madam Clerk, if you'll announce the vote, 21 yes, 2 no, 1 absent, or 1 abstain, 1 absent. Next resolution is Resolution 180809. It's a resolution appointing members of the County Board of Health. Have a motion.
So moved.
A motion made by Commissioner Carrier, seconded by Commissioner England to approve this. Mr. Singleton, will you tell us a little bit about? County Board of Health, the mayor appointed.
With regard to the Board of Health, the commission is allowed to actually, they may elect a doctor of veterinary medicine, and they may elect a citizen representative as other additional members of the County Board of Health.
So it doesn't have to be a county commissioner then?
That's correct.
Who made, did you say made those recommendations? The mayor or the commission?
This is the county commission, county legislative body.
Well, I think Dr. Jones is very well qualified for this position, and I think the doctor is perfect. Do you need a motion?
We have a motion and a second on the floor to approve the resolution. More of a, just a clarification been requested. Commissioner Johnson?
I do not know, Ms. Jones, is she connected to the health profession?
She
works in family medicine and psychology, does an excellent job.
No question.
Question when it comes. Madam Clerk, if you'll switch us to the voting screen. Go ahead and cast your vote and lock it in. Madam Clerk, if you'll announce the vote, 24 yes, 0 no. Resolution passes. Next resolution is Resolution 180810. It's a resolution confirming the county mayor's recommendation for appointees to the board of the Johnson City Development Authority. Motion made by Commissioner Story to approve resolution, seconded by Commissioner Chase. Mr. Seaman, will you?
With regard to the JCPA, the mayor recommends appointment. The county commission confirms, but then these are taken to the city commission, and the
Discussion. Madam Clerk, if you'll switch us to the voting screen, please. Go ahead and cast your vote, lock it in. 23 yes, one no, one absent, resolution passes. Next resolution is 180811, it's a resolution confirming the county mayor's recommendation for appointments to the Tax Increment Fund Advisory Board of Johnson City Development Authority.
Move approval.
Motion made by Commissioner Chase to approve the resolution, seconded by Commissioner Hinson. Mr. Seeley, if you'll tell us about this one.
The mayor recommends the appointments, county commission confirm those appointments.
Are these terms expired?
Yes.
Terms have expired. Any further discussion?
Question.
Question's been called. Madam Clerk, if you'll switch us to the voting screen. Go ahead and cast your vote, lock it in. 22 yes, one no, abstained, one absent, resolution passes. Last resolution is resolution 180821, it's a resolution confirming the sheriff's appointments to the workforce committee.
So move.
Second.
Motion made by Commissioner Johnson, seconded by Commissioner Stanton. They were setting you out over there, Commissioner Stanton.
Yes.
These appointments are made by the sheriff, or these recommendations are made by the sheriff to the commission. Any further discussion?
Question.
Question's been called. Madam Clerk, if you'll switch us to the voting screen. Go ahead and cast your vote, lock it in. Madam Clerk, if you'll announce the vote, 23 yes, zero no, one abstained, one absent, resolution passes. All right, now to the official committee reports, the CIA committee, Commissioner Hinson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Email August 9th, we'll find our minutes on page 48 of the packet. Two items to discuss. Director Mayor has brought forth some financials, kind of lay out the, our expenditures of the Washington County Justice Department, that's included in part of the minutes. And the second thing, the paint for us, the inmate healthcare situation we need to deal with. We do have two resolutions to vote for that. The first one is resolution 180812, that authorizes the mayor to enter into an MOU with Fowler. And that's an MOU concerning the reimbursement for inmate medical costs. And that comes to you for the motion.
Got a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Grant. Discussion.
Question.
Question's been called. Madam Clerk, if you'll switch us to the voting screen. Go ahead and cast your vote, lock it in. zero, no, one absent, resolution passes.
Second, resolution number 2018-08-13, that is a resolution authorizing the mayor to contract for stock loss medical insurance. For, this is also related to healthcare, this is very similar to what we've done for the county board. That comes to you, and then come up.
Motion made by Commissioner Hensley. Seconded, seconded by Commissioner Hodge. I think there's a little bit of discussion about this resolution. Mayor, do you have something?
I will share with you, you see the resolution specifically asks for as much as $175,000 to be moved to pay for this stock loss coverage. This is a liability insurance policy. We've been working for 6 weeks, I guess, to try to get this worked out. As it stands today, we are probably looking at a different set of coverages from what this was priced on. So we're actually looking at cost significantly less than the $175,000. It is still liability insurance, it's stock loss coverage. We're looking at a higher deductible. We have been looking at a $10,000 deductible. We're now looking at a $100,000 deductible. And we're looking at limits of either $250,000 or $500,000 per inmate per policy year. So we're hopeful to have this resolved this week. But for your purposes tonight, I want you to understand that the amount of money we're talking about is probably going to be substantial.
What is the policy?
It's 12 months from there to put in place. Our goal is to put in place effective September 1, but I don't want to guarantee that tonight. But it's 12 months coverage from the point we put in place.
Yes, it's a major change, increase in deductible.
Yes, that's a big change. And the reason why we're talking about a higher deductible is because we, believe it or not, we've learned an amazing amount about inmate health care cost over the last several weeks. And we now understand where those costs are concentrated and what we need to actually be insuring for. So we only want to buy coverage for the portion that we really need. That's how we're able to reduce the cost.
Mr. Chairman, if I might ask a question.
Yes, Commissioner.
The deductible part, how are we going to protect ourselves on that?
Well, that goes back to the MOU with Valid. Valid in the MOU that is being reviewed by their legal staff and, of course, by our county attorney. Basically says that Valid will absorb the first $10,000 of cost, which is the vast majority of our expenses. Most of the expenses that we incur with Valid Healthcare are actually related to the emergency room. So,
if you have an inmate that has a $60,000 bill, 40 of that we're going to have to cover?
40 of that we will cover. We've got an insurance specialist that is looking at this for us to advise us on how to reserve for that, what would be an appropriate reserve. Essentially, he's doing the
actuarial
responsibility for us. So
Wait and cast your vote, lock it in. Madam Clerk, if you'll announce the vote. 24 yeses, 0 no's. One absent, resolution passes.
That's all we have, Mr. Chairman. Folks have your questions, please.
Thank you, Commissioner. Next report is the county attorney's report, Mr. Stevens.
I have no written report, but I'll answer any questions that you have.
Thank you, Mr. Stevens. County mayor's report, Mayor Elkins.
Last one. I really don't have much to say about it. I do want to share this with you, though. I truly count it a blessing to serve as mayor of this great county for the last 8 years. And I appreciate everyone that has supported me and encouraged me every step of the way. It's been a period of time marked by transition and change that I believe has been productive and beneficial for our citizens. We've made great strides in many areas, and today Washington County is stronger financially and better positioned for the future than it has ever been. Through your leadership and involvement, the accomplishments of this commission term have been many, and by my estimation have been more impactful for the long-term prosperity of the residents of Washington County than those of any previous commission. You have displayed a vision and commitment for the future and made difficult decisions necessary to implement plans and strategies that will yield great benefits for our children and our grandchildren, my grandchild. I think that's exactly what you were elected to do, and I am proud to have been able to serve with you. To my successor, Joe Grandy, I wish you the very best. You're starting in a good place, just as I did following George James 8 years ago, and I know that you'll do well. And for the future leaders of this county, I want to leave this one thought. Educational attainment and readiness of the emerging workforce will have a greater impact on the future prosperity of this county and this region than any other factor. Please make it the priority. Thank you for the privilege of serving as the county mayor of Washington County. And now I'd like to ask Mitch to come up and give you a final recap on the fiscal 2018 financial results.
$1 billion to its fund balance, its general fund balance this year. So, new
new commission. Expenses keep going up, but at least we're going in the right direction. Highway Department finished the year with adding $1.3 million to Johnny's fund balance. That was compared to budgeted use of almost $1.6 million. Solid waste, we're still going to have some struggles with solid waste going forward. It ended up using about $300,000 of its fund balance. It's a $1.2 million fund. So we'll just need to look at some revenue items in that fund to help offset some of those expenditures. Debt service performed, we were expecting this. Debt service used $1.6 million from a fund balance. We originally budgeted to use $1.7, so it was a little bit better. But we planned on using some of those reserves this year. Because of the new debt issuance we did at the end of June 17, we had those payments we had to get plugged in. Capital projects, of course, most of that was actually budgeted in the prior year when we cranked up with Boone's Creek School, but I am pleased to result that $11.3 million was the actual revenue in the capital projects fund. Current year expenditures over and above those that were encumbered in the prior year was $6.6 million, which meant we had about a $4.7 million surplus in capital projects. Now, we had a significant deficit last year, so that kind of ebbed and flowed. And then, of course, our self-insurance fund, which is the other one. If you recall, last year, as we ended June of 17, we were about $1 million in the hole on our self-insurance fund for FY17 operations. This year, we have put back about $1.2 million in self-insurance, so we've about balanced it out. And, you know, for the commissioners that will be here in the future, remember, the self-insurance fund is not a one-year standalone fund. We need to have some reserves in there to offset catastrophic losses. We have some stop-loss insurance for that, but I think financially and fiscally it's prudent to have some reserves. If you'll look at the very back, the last three pages of your handout, I'm going to just, the first one looks something like this. Maybe it's the second picture. I just want to explain what this is doing. This graph right here essentially lists all the general government expenditures we have. That includes debt service or capital projects, but it includes highway, solid waste, and the general fund. And what we've done is we've graphed them since 2008, our actual expenditures out through 2018. The line at the top is actually what inflation has done over that same period. Okay, I just thought it was kind of interesting to see where our expenses are in relation to where they would have been had they just been tagged with inflationary numbers. And you know, we've added some things in here, and I think what I'm trying to say is that you all have done a good job, the administration's done a good job, the office holders have done an excellent job of maintaining their expenses. Because otherwise, you can see this last bar being way above the inflation line. So I think that's an accolade, you know, to our county officials. The next graph, or the one right before that, I guess it really looks like this, is actually what our various fund balances are. And of course, if we added some this year, you can see that in 2018 our fund balances were up. Of course, most of that is in capital projects. I had a commissioner that had requested some information on what we had done in terms of school funding over the last 4 years. Those are the last two graphs in your packet. And essentially what they are, is the first graph is what property tax is. What the commission has appropriated to education in terms of property tax. If you'll recall or remember, we have a property tax rate for the general purpose school fund. We have a property tax rate for the debt service fund, of which 83 to 85% of debt service is all educational related. Some prior
schools and vault buses and et cetera. And then we have, we originally started with 26 kennings in our capital projects fund for school-related activities. That has since dropped to 20 because we had to move money from the Boone's Creek borrowing to debt service. So that's why the pennies move a little bit. But what this is showing is, in essence, how much money, and the, that graph kind of indicates the trend this commission has taken to allot funds to property tax funds to education. And of course, you know, again, keep in mind though that the operational funds are split with the city of Johnson City. So that upward trend, you know, benefits not only Washington County, but also the city school system. So I think that doesn't need to be overlooked. And then the last, on the very last page, this is actually our local funding. And the top section there represents the actual dollars that the school system has collected in terms of local taxes from 2013 through its 2019 budget year. And you can kind of see it's following the same trend. That the local taxes also include Washington County schools' share of the local sales tax. So the dollars, you know, the first graph is kind of showing how, we're showing how property tax dollars were spent. This one is actually showing total local dollars, which includes sales tax, property tax, mixed rate tax, you name it. Those are all there. So with that, I'll entertain any questions anyone might have on the finances. We hope to have the audit wrapped up. Maybe have the audit report November, could be December, but hopefully they've already started. And hopefully it'll be a lot cleaner, a lot easier this year for everybody since our auditors are on there. Anybody have any questions?
None of this reflects sales tax revenue.
The last graph does. The last page does include in local taxes, it does include the county share of local, Washington County school system's share of local sales tax.
Do you know what that dollar amount is?
$13 million? No, it's a lot for sales tax. A little over $15 million for what they reported in FY 18. He sent that to me today, but I didn't know what the number was. Any other questions? Well, I want to also just take a second and following Mayor Eldridge's comments. For those of you that I served with for 7 years, 3 years on this commission, I want you to know that each and every one of you, I do truly appreciate serving with you. I respect each and every one of you, and I wish though that we'll be here next month, all the continued success. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
funding terms, that's a big deal for us. We've got 8,440 students involved as of this morning. Also, Mr. Chairman, in a moment, the commission will consider resolution 180817, these funds are associated with the resolution. We have much needed funds for building repair, new buses and some technology. I solicit your support, commission, and thank you in advance for a favorable vote. And answer the question you might have. Thank you.
Thank you.
Dr. Flannery.
Dr. Flannery.
You want to tell us how your skydiving went?
Damn.
2 weeks ago, as the guest of the United States Army, I went skydiving. It's the first time in my life I will do that. It will be the last time.
Mr. Mabe is leaving the school board. He had requested a few minutes to speak to the commission tonight. Are there any objections?
Mr. Mabe,
if you'll come on up. Appreciate your many years of service.
Relationship of coordination and mutual respect has existed between the commission, the school board, and the mayor, and especially on Mr. Dyke's tenure. We also thank you for always listening to concerns of financial needs. Hundreds of thousands. Give thousands of dollars for pavement and building upgrades. I appreciate that. One of the most important things you did was that you modernized our technology. What will the library look like in 10 years from now? What will the textbook look like in 10 years from now? You took that consideration and you kept us by Chromebooks, you kept us by smart boards, you kept teachers with microphones. That is awesome because that is in the classroom for every kid. That's what I call a tire meets a road, and I appreciate that as a board member. Furthermore, you funded the construction of Grandview, Ridgeview, and now Boone Street. You did it right. You didn't half-ass anything. I'm sorry to say that way. It's true. And I'm proud of it. Thank you again for loving the kids of Washington County. And I love each and every one. Thank you.
Is the Employee Compensation and Benefits Committee, Commissioner McAllister.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You'll find our report on page 57. Our two major issues we discussed. The first one was we looked at a no-show fee of $15 for appointments for the employees who had missed their appointments at the health clinic. We discussed this much in depth and monitoring this over the past few months. And continue to get higher and higher. And we thought this was one way we would try to do this. like you'll find, read the resolution here, your first no-show, that's well, kind of a pass. The second no-show, that we'll start charging $15. That goes to after the calendar years. So at this time, I would like to present resolution 180815 for approval of a $15 fee for Washington County employees who miss scheduled appointments at the employee health clinic.
Motion by Commissioner McAllister. Have a second.
Second
by Commissioner Johnson. Discussion.
Yes,
Commissioner Chase.
Did the committee feel that 15 was a sufficient deterrent?
We had, and I've got Michelle Stewart. Michelle made the help. Appreciate Michelle being here, because I think we're the only health care here has like eight different clinics. I think us in Bristol are the only ones that do not have a no-show fee. And I think ours is $15 was exactly about average or getting here.
Our clinic manager helped us come up with that fee. She suggested at least $10. The upper scale is about $25, so we felt comfortable with a $15 no-show fee, taking into account if an employee missed a regular doctor's appointment that wasn't in the clinic, they would be charged at least that much, if not their copay. So we felt $15 was a beginning point and a comfortable place to start.
And Care Here does try to notify them by text, by phone, any to remind them, and you can do it all the way up to 5 minutes before your appointment. You can cancel. You won't be charged for no-show fee.
The clinic staff has also, as they have built relationships with employees and dependents, if they realize it's 5 minutes till 10 and an employee at 10 o'clock is not there yet and that person's usually early, they actually physically call them themselves. They don't just rely on the automated text message or email reminder that they get. Our clinic staff is going above and beyond to try to remind people. The problem has gotten a bit out of hand. There were 2 weeks in July that we had 19 no-shows in 2 weeks. That was over half of the clinic visit in a week's time. So that was not a good use of our dollars, nor a good use of our clinic time.
And our clinic appointments have been full. We've booked every clinic appointment.
I noticed in this, there's no, what happens if there is there anything taking into consideration if there is an emergency that an employee cannot, or a family member cannot call and cancel that, would that be taken into consideration, or is it automatically the second one, regardless of that?
No,
the first one's free, and the second one's get you, right?
The plan is, each week when I get the no-show list, currently right now what I do is send out a paper reminder to the employees and say, you missed your appointment on this day and time. I will continue to do that, but those that no-show the first time, I will send them a note that explains you no-showed this time. If there is a circumstance, for example, last week we had an employee that called the clinic and canceled, but the call center did not take them off the list. So when the employee got their notice from me, they called me and they said, but Jill, I called and canceled that appointment. So I want to give employees the opportunity to let me know if something like that happens. If it does, I call back to the clinic staff and the manager. She pulled the call logs from the day the employee called and listened, and yes, the employee did call me. It was just an error on the carrier part. And those kind of things can happen. So my plan is to send each employee that notice, that reminder, and if it isn't their fault, if they no-showed, if they did call Care Here or they tried to cancel online and it didn't make it in time, then we would not count that against.
And if you notice, that fee does go into the self-insurance fund. We're not trying to make any money off this. It just goes back into the self-insurance fund.
The goal is just to have employees be more mindful of their employees and their dependents. For example, I have a dependent that has missed 5 appointments at the clinic since February.
But would it be taken into consideration if there had been, if there is an emergency or something, that would be considered,
yes.
Right?
Yes. And I have even gone so far to tell employees, if you have an emergency and you can't cancel, call me, I'll cancel it for you. Or shoot me a text and I'll be glad to try to help handle that. This is not something that the clinic staff or the manager and I went into half-heartedly. We have looked at the numbers month in, and we've watched them steadily increase. And it's to the point where the no-shows are costing us money at the clinic, and our costs are going to continue to escalate at this point.
22, yes, 2, no, 1 absent. Resolution passes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Next resolution we have is Resolution 180828. It's a resolution adopting the Washington County, Tennessee-based personnel policy and employee handbook. I'd like to present this as a motion from our committee.
Motion made by Commissioner McAllister. Now, was that 1808?
28.
28?
Yes.
Okay.
Second
by Commissioner Chase to approve the resolution. Discussion?
This will be perfectly clear. I got it clear.
Commissioner Ford?
This will not affect officers that already has one in place. Am I correct, Mr.
Simpson?
Yes, sir. That's correct. This, again, the Sheriff's Department, the Highway Department, any of the elected officials that adopt their own personnel policy, their personnel policy will supersede the base personnel policy. The base personnel policy is in effect for the county employees and those elected officials' offices that don't have a personnel policy in place. So, Mr. Ford.
Any further discussion?
Call for question.
Question been called. Madam Clerk, if you'll switch us to the voting screen. Go ahead and cast your vote and lock it in. Madam Clerk, if you'll announce the vote, 23 yes, 1 no. 1 absent, resolution passes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The last thing I have, just on page 69, I hope you have a chance to look. There's a letter thanking Ms. Michelle Stewart, one of our constituents. And Michelle goes above and beyond. I appreciate all she does for our committee and what she does for our county employees. So I hope you get a chance to read that. I just want to publicly thank Michelle for all she does. Thank you, Michelle. And that's all I have. Unless there are any further questions for me, that's all I have.
Thank you, Commissioner McAllister. All right. Next report is the Health, Education, and Welfare Committee. Commissioner Krieger.
Our minutes are on page 125. That's of our meeting. Some of the items that we have to bring for you, there is an attachment in there on strengthening college attainment, completion of regional strategy. It's in your packet. And Mayor, this Wednesday, I believe, at Great Meadows.
Yes. Wednesday from 8 a.m. until 3:30 p.m. We have educators, we have business people, we've got local government folks, we've got school board members, county commissioners from all over Northeast Tennessee. They'll be attending a summit to really get focused on what it's going to take to improve completion, post-secondary completion in Northeast Tennessee. Okay. The name of the summit is Education to Employment, which is really the whole strategy that we're trying to get our arms around. How do we make sure that these kids are being educated and trained to the level that they qualify for better jobs, knowing full well that a qualified workforce is going to create better paying jobs. So that's everybody, any of you that have got any interest in that, we really encourage you to be there. This is just the beginning of this effort, and as I say, it is for the entire region.
Can someone still enroll in that?
Yes. Okay. That's not too late.
That is this Wednesday, and that should be a great session. So thank you for hosting that. Okay, also we have for you on page 131 that the budget resolution memo. That has to do with funding on school capital project items. And as you'll see there, if you go down to the bottom, building improvements, South Central, $560,000, which was $110,000 increase from what was in the original plan. And that's simply because the original plan was 2 or 3 years old, and the long buses and one small bus is what we approved if they're needed. And here again, this is coming out of the capital expenditure fund, so it's not limited. I mean, it is limited. It's not a finite amount, so everyone's doing everything, including the school administration, to keep these expenses down. Also, we have Clarence Mays talked about school technology, $640,000 school technology. That was not in the original budget because at that point the budget was put together, the school board had not taken a position on how those Chromebooks were going to be handled. Were they going to be issued and kids could take them home or not? They've since made a decision on that. The Chromebooks will be staying in the schools, and they will be issued to the appropriate classes at the discretion of the school board and school administration. And so the unassigned fund balance will therefore decrease by $1 million. And so I bring to you the resolution on the next page, 18-08-17. Make that as a motion that we approve those expenditures out of the capital expenditure fund.
Motion made by Commissioner Krieger, seconded by Commissioner Larkin to approve the resolution. Commissioner Hester.
Mr. Chairman, my employer is currently serving as school board architect, so I'm going to abstain from the vote on this item and refute myself for the discussion.
Thank you. Further discussion?
Call the question.
Question, go ahead and call. Clerk, if you'll switch to the voting screen. Go ahead and cast your vote and lock it in. Field announced the vote 23 yes, 0 no, 2 absent. Resolution passes.
Okay, and then we have one other item to bring before you, and that's the resolution 18-08-16, and that's the resolution regarding opiate abuse, addiction, morbidity, and mortality in Washington County, Tennessee. And what this is asking us to do is to approve initiating a lawsuit against a number of different drug firms, and in an effort to try to recuperate some of the expenditures that we made as a county to our jail, to our law enforcement and everything. And Attorney Ron Jesse is here that will answer any questions exactly what this is. This costs the county nothing if we don't win the case. The attorney is working on a equal to kill basis. If they win, they take 30%. If they lose, they're out that, and the cost is not enough. But I would entertain a question to this, and if you would come up to the podium, I'd appreciate it, and perhaps educate our group much more better than I can on this issue.
Thank you all. Hearing from me, we're proposing, we as a group, six law firms have been working on gathering clients to participate in the lawsuit. We have, as of this morning, filed approval with Lauderdale, so we're up to 15 counties in Tennessee, counties in many other states. There's a total of over 1,000 entities, governmental entities, that are participating at the federal level. First off, please understand this is not a class action. This is your case. It will be tried in federal court in Greenville. If it is not resolved by settlement, it will be a jury from the federal district area that covers based in Greenville. It will be tried by me and other lawyers here. As I said, this is not a class action. Some of you know that I do class action work. So each case is individual. The reason it is in the Northern District of Ohio is because the judge that they assigned it to is getting all of the federal opioid cases. This lawsuit primarily sues the six manufacturers and the rest are distributors. There are no local pharmacists. There are no law doctors. It's just the national companies, either manufacturers or distributors. It covers nuisance, misrepresentation, specifically Racketeering and Corrupt Practices Act, which is a federal cause of action that we don't have in Tennessee. I was approached to try to ask counties to come. Friends of mine who started this in West Virginia 2012 have been working through this process. And they called us primarily because, one, I knew them, and because our constitution matches language of West Virginia's, and they had already settled their state case in 2014. But their counties opted out. And the reason this seems to make the best sense is if you look at the Constitution of Tennessee, look at our history, the place that nuisance has been dealt with has been at the county level. It's a local problem and it requires a local solution. The tobacco litigation is the perfect example. That was a class action. The money went to the states that participated and not one dime came down here. Virginia was wise enough to put theirs in a trust fund. Southwest Virginia has benefited tremendously from applying to those funds, but Tennessee chose to keep it at the state level, not here. This would be your case. As Mr. Krieger said, it's a contingent fee case. It's a 30% fee on what you recover. If you recover nothing, there is no cost. We will pay for all the costs incurred and we'll be responsible for those costs. If we're not successful, there's no money owed on any cost as well, and we would defend any attempt at a counterclaim, although to date there have been no counterclaims at these federal level cases. We feel that it's moving extremely well. This judge is just spectacular. The reason he was picked is he had a case that involved a lot of citizens filing individual claims over a chemical issue that was not a class, so he had a huge number of plaintiffs, just as this case would be, and he was able to manage that through the three-year process and then ultimately get the case settled. He's already required us to put together a settlement committee, which consists of one lawyer from each of the defendants that have been sued, and a team of six lawyers from the plaintiff's side, which would be you, and two of the guys that I'm working with are on that committee. So those discussions have already started. We uploaded today material from counties here in Tennessee. The judge has ordered a series of questions to be answered to send information up the pipeline now so that the defendants have a very good picture of what we're talking about. What it consists of is, if you'll think about it, I was in Cock County and they spent their entire medical budget for the jail for the year by March. They didn't have any more money. I heard you all talk tonight about the cost of the jail costs. If you really think about it, your jail is the place where they detox. They have nowhere else to go. Our homeless population, how many of them detox on the street or continue to take drugs on the street? We're big on fact. Tobacco litigation proved there has to be money for education at this level to deal with prescription drugs and drugs generally. If you don't start it in kindergarten, it's not going to happen. We know what it does healthcare wise. We know you have to have funds for things like providing rehab services, drug courts, and whatever it takes. So that's what our hope is. That's what our plan is. Litigation has gone well. We have some amazing experts. Some former DEA executives have been testifying on our behalf. Discovery has started. Judge is talking about trying first five cases next August. What's interesting is, of course, there's criticism a little bit, jealousy a little bit about, well, if you take this poor county in Tennessee and take them up there to Ohio, they'll just forget about us. Nobody realizes the county in Tennessee will come back here to try their case, but the judge has heard all that, so he said, well, I'm going to try five cases from Ohio, because I know I got the power to do that. I'm a judge in Ohio. So they're focusing very hard on getting these things ready, which should tell us a lot about what the position of the pharmaceutical manufacturers and the wholesale distributors. We are asking you to approve a resolution. Mr. Seeley and I have exchanged the resolution contract, and usually when a county signs their contract, we'll have this filed in the next 10 days. Anybody have any questions?
Yes, Ken, I apologize. You may have said this earlier, but how was this generated? I mean, you said six firms, law firms got together, did someone come approach you?
What basically happened was the Attorney General in West Virginia filed a case in 2012 against certain manufacturers. Our Attorney General, back some time ago, filed against one manufacturer. Well, when the settlement of the West Virginia case in 2014 started, a lawyer in Morgantown, West Virginia, who's somebody that they approached me to be on our on the team here, he went back and said, you know, this is not the way to do this. This is a county problem, and I want to look at this from a county point of view. And that's when West Virginia start looking at the idea of individual counties bringing these cases as nuisance cases. And if you'll think about it, 50 years ago, if you wanted to close a liquor house or house of prostitution or had to stop the tannery from throwing dead cows in the river, the state didn't come down here to do anything. It was the county sheriff, the county chancery court, all those entities that are right here in the county had to clean up the county. And he realized this is the problem. The money needs to come here if there's going to be any money. So they started filing the cases, and when they filed them in federal court, once you get a certain number, there is what's called multi-district litigation. So West Virginia filed some other states, individual counties started filing. That's when the federal court committee meets and says, okay, we're going to assign these to one judge. I just finished a year and a half ago the Southeastern Dairy Farmers Association members' price-fixing case, and the judge that took that was Judge Greer in Greene County. So all the Southeastern Dairy Farmer cases came here to Greenville. Well, once this builds, the federal court assigns it to the judge in the Northern District of Ohio, and throughout the United States, counties have continued to evaluate and file the cases. Three counties in California have already settled some cases against some individual defendants. So that's sort of the momentum that started it. And they got the idea of calling Tennessee, and they happen to know me, because like I said, our constitution sort of matches theirs. So that's the way they start looking. They also represent, I'm not on those cases with, they represent both the Eastern and Western Band of the Cherokees and two other Indian nations who have also filed lawsuits. There's cities like Cleveland, Cincinnati, there's counties throughout the United States.
Can I ask how much you're seeking in damages?
It's a huge number. It's not a number that is focused on, we know we want this much. The speech that is usually given is that a county this size would need multiple years damages to cover the cost of refitting, dealing with addicts that we have to bring into our GI jails. The one presentation I've seen, a county three times this size, there was a presentation at one of the meetings I went to where they proposed that it would take 5 years at $50 million a year to do what they wanted to do. So it is a huge number. It pales compared to tobacco is literally a small number compared to what could be estimated. If they're successful, It is a huge number, but one distributor alone, McKesson, is the third largest corporation in the United States. It's a huge number, but there are huge dollars. One distributor 6 years ago paid $10 million in fine for failure to report to the DEA. The next time they got fined, they paid $50 million. And 2 years ago, January, they paid $150 million in fines. Same company's been fined three times. So it's a huge number.
Thank you.
In anticipation of this going forward, are there things that as a county government we need to be doing to identify some of our costs associated with this very subject matter?
I was pleasantly surprised because that was the thing I was scared of when I get the call and they said go figure out where they spent their money. The judge, the defendants wanted a questionnaire of some 20 pages. The judge cut it to five. It's gone out to our counties that we represent here in Tennessee that have already filed. I have been amazingly surprised how organized you all are. The questions that they asked for was certified budgets, how many times have you changed your sheriff, how many times have you spent money over jails. But it is so amazingly focused to the way you already put your information together that we sent out the questionnaire to each county government. I called each one and said, this is what we're looking for. Don't panic. Just start looking. We started the callbacks last week. We've averaged about 45 minutes per county on the phone. And quite frankly, we've got two-thirds of the information. So you all do an amazing job of knowing, like you just got done talking about, the cost of health care from the jail. So I'm very pleased. It will not be, at least on this first go-round, will not be the burden I was originally afraid it might be. I've been very pleased. And I was surprised even the smallest county. What y'all need to realize is Campbell County, which we represent, is the number four in the United States per capita death rate from opioids. Claiborne County is number five. I was surprised how efficient Johnson County was and already got their first round of information in. So I think if you just keep doing what you're doing, you already know. You already know it's there.
Is there a federal lawsuit that's in process now that was superseded by the one that we're talking about this evening that was pulled this up?
No, the only question, and it might be, if you've read all the papers, the DAs from the districts 2, 3, and 1 filed a separate lawsuit. One DA says we're in no conflict, no problem. One DA and the other district says, well, we think there might be a conflict. The state and the DAs got into it over state attorney general over, well, who could file the lawsuit, and they've agreed to kind of split that up. And the state filed one in Knox County. None of them can file a RICO, federal RICO, in state court. So number one, we're the only, if we filed it, that cause of action unquestionably is up there. Now, the DAs might be right. We had a concern with the local DAs because one, you all don't vote on that, they just filed it. And two, the law that they're basing it on is a drug, it's called Drug Dealer Act, Tennessee Drug Dealer Act. Almost word for word what Oklahoma passed some years ago, and that's been declared unconstitutional. We're very worried, even filing them, about the issue of statute of limitations. Some of these questions are very pointed about when did you first realize you had an opioid problem? Well, we think at best we have a 3-year rolling statute of limitations. So computing damages, but no, I don't. I really, there is not one master case, and no one has filed, no entity or individual has filed a class action trying to make it one case. And I think because it is so unique, in that obviously Claiborne County, Johnson County, Washington County have a whole totally different picture of numbers versus New York City and Cincinnati that are in the case. So this allows them to move forward individually.
We hired you. What would be a reasonable expectation of the time from the beginning to the end of this year?
I assume we could get down here to your courtroom and find one that's been pending since you went on the bench the first time.
No, no.
I can tell you that I have been privileged to appear before a lot of judges. And, you know, there's hanging judges and docket pushing judges and all that. This is the most focused, articulate, practical judge I've seen. So my sincere belief is that his idea is next August to try five in Ohio, pull five from Mississippi to try next. So if all umpteen thousand of them were to go to trial, if you remember, when it's time, if it's realized you can't settle them, they all spread back out to their individual judges. So if this case came back to East Tennessee, I would say it's a year from when it comes back. And I think we'll know by August of next year whether they're staying and settling or whether they're coming back.
3 years?
3 years. I would think we'd have a practical, a lot depend on the individual court that it's in, but in Greene County, 3 years, 3.5 years, I would think is reasonable. We did milk with the dairy farmers in about 4.5 years. And what we're lucky about is because we don't have a class, it makes it a little bit easier to honestly move things, and I didn't think it would. But when he can reach out and go, we're going to try your case tomorrow, and it makes a big difference with the defendants. Thank you all. I appreciate it.
How did your milk case?
We settled it. We were very pleased. The dairy farmers, it was dairy farmers versus Dean Foods and the Dairy Farmers of America. And we were very pleased with that settlement. And Judge Greer was a great judge to try it. But that covered all southeastern dairy farmers that were members or milk was bought. They're still having a hard time with milk production now, though. Anybody got anything else? Thank you all.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Call a question.
Commissioner Ford, did you have a question? Madam Clerk, we have a motion. I know that Commissioner Krieger made the motion.
I need a second.
Seconded by Commissioner Hensley.
Call a question.
Mr. Chase.
Mr. Jesse is an honorable man, and I've known him for a very long time, and I take him at his word, but I did know that the resolution does not contain the fee structure that was indicated to that issue.
Mr.
Chase. Yes, sir.
Further discussion. Madam Clerk, if you'll switch it to the voting screen. Go ahead and cast your vote, my friends. Madam Clerk, if you'll announce the vote of 23 yes, 1 no. But absent, the resolution passes.
Thank you.
item is the Public Records Commission. Commissioner Humphries?
Now, this minute, there's something to add to the head. We didn't file it, I don't think.
All right, thank you, Commissioner Humphries. Item is the Public Safety Committee report. Commissioner Ford?
Jeremy, it's on page 153. We have a resolution tonight for this commission to consider. It's on page 153, or excuse me, on page 156, and I'll have to get a form of the motion.
Second. Motion made by Commissioner Ford, seconded by Commissioner Lott to approve the resolution. Discussion? Madam Clerk, if you'll switch us to voting screen. Go ahead and cast your vote and lock it in. Not effective until September. Commissioner Dunn, our constable, is effectively submitting his resignation as constable due to some health issues. And we want to thank Constable Dunn and we'll give this to the county attorney and for him to review that and bring it back for some further discussion next month. All right, next item is the Public Works Committee. Commissioner Davenport?
Yes, you'll find our minutes on page 159 of our August 16th meeting. First order of business, would like to address how it's like for us to enter into the minutes of this meeting, the Washington County Highway Department's employee handbook, which we discussed handbooks a little bit before, and the Highway Department has their own handbook. I would just like for that handbook to go into the minutes of this meeting.
All right.
Okay. We do have one resolution, 1808-27, resolution authorizing the disposition of Highway Department surplus money. This is a lovely trailer that that comes in the form of a
second. Motion made by Commissioner Davenport, seconded by Commissioner Ford to approve the resolution. Discussion? Question? Madam Clerk, if you'll switch us to the voting screen. Go ahead and cast your vote and lock it in. Zero, no, or absent. Resolution passes.
That's all I have.
Actually, the one we added to the highway.
Sorry. Oh, yes. Resolution 1808-30. Resolution amending fiscal year budget 2018 and highway budget state project of state as well. That's the former motion.
I'm sorry, by Commissioner Davenport, seconded by Commissioner Ford. To approve the resolution. Discussion?
Question?
Question. Madam Clerk, if you'll switch us to the voting screen. Go ahead and cast your vote and lock it in. vote, 24 yes, 0 no, 1 absent. Resolution passes. Is that all before you, Commissioner?
I don't think so, unless you have anything else for me.
No. Next item is the Washington County Justice Board of Health meeting. You'll find those meetings in your packet, page 213 in May. Library Board of Trustees, those minutes in your packet, July 17th minutes, on page 216. And the Washington County Committee for Resale of Land, Commissioner Chase. Kind of threw you under the bus on that one, maybe one.
Page 216, did you say?
Yeah. 242.
242, I'm sorry.
Two resolutions.
Why don't you just go ahead and give that report?
Okay. You want me to go ahead and work on the Commissioner Tester?
Well, I think just a minute at a time. There was a resolution under the library section to appoint a board member. I don't know if that was, kind of got lost in there, or if it's on page 235.
I must have one of those expired agendas. Do you have that, Mr. Seeley?
I don't have it. We don't have a library board. Well, it's on page 235 of the package, so.
I'll bet you there'll be a mix.
See there, I'm on it.
Thank you, Commissioner Chase. All right, Commissioner Chase.
The committee did read, and we have two items of consideration. One, and I'll ask Attorney Seeley if he will to address it, and it's involving quick claiming some county and property with the Emeryville Fire Department.
The Emeryville Fire Chief requested this. It turns out that their property is not a joint state right of way order, so he can negotiate with the state to deed to him the county right of way. And this was something we will not maintain. So again, we recommend that we deed this to the Emeryville Fire Department. This is going to allow them to begin to negotiate with the state, dealing with the state's right of way.
Motion made by Commissioner Lyons, seconded by Commissioner Edens to approve the resolution. Discussion?
All questions.
Questions at the top? Madam Clerk, if you'll switch us to voting screen. Go ahead and cast your vote and lock it in. Madam Clerk, if you'll announce the vote. 24 yes, 0 no, 1 absent. Resolution passes.
The second item was concerning the upcoming delinquent tax sale. Attorney Lawrence Counts has identified three properties that, if they are not sold in the tax sale, and they do revert back to the county, that it could present a potential financial burden to the county. Those properties are identified in the minutes, and so we have a resolution to address the event that they are not sold.
Have a motion.
So moved. Question
made by Commissioner Chase, seconded by Commissioner Carrier.
Yeah. Commissioner Chase, did you say three properties?
Yes, I believe that is correct.
I would say, I was looking for the meets and bounds description, that is just to identify the items.
Okay, right.
Commissioner Johnson?
This is a very important item for the county. Chancery Court has jurisdiction over tax sales. And many years, county automatically did in the properties. Problem was, he had bid in an old service station general store where the tanks were leaking and all kinds of problems. So it's extremely good that we look at these properties and not buy a lawsuit.
Call question.
Commissioner Tester?
No problem.
On page 252, the letter from the attorney, the first line says, "The following properties do not pose an environmental problem." So what are the problems with these properties? Can somebody elaborate a little bit on that?
Mr. Seaman, do you want to elaborate on any? I know when we...
Mr. Counts has provided us some information that was not an environmental issue, as the one Commissioner Johnson discussed, that just the financial liabilities with the properties. If one was too small to develop, it would be extremely hard for resale. The other was a long narrow strip of land, which again would have no use of standalone parcel, or would only be valuable to adjoining property owners. But again, it was financial liability on both of these properties. Not to be beneficial to the county to take this in. Better off trying to sell this or get the adjoining property owners to purchase those pieces of property.
Sounds like irregular shaped properties that are only good for holding the earth together.
Have we tried to sell them once before?
Not these. One of the things we got into,
Well, I was just going to say, these are properties that have gone through the, that they have been delinquent tax properties for some period of time. The chancellor is, through the clerk of master's office, is now instructed that they be sold for the taxes owed. And the challenge that we have is particularly in the cases of these type properties, I'm trying to think of how many of these the county actually owns right now, but it's several where it's literally a useless piece of property. And the county is in the process, which is a very laborious, time-consuming process, of going to adjoining property owners and literally asking them to agree to take ownership of this property so we can get it back in the tax rolls. And what Mr. Counts has done is, at our request, his staff evaluated every piece of property that is proposed to be in this sale. These are the three that he saw potential liability for the county. The statute was actually changed last year, maybe it was year before last. The statute was changed. It had always, for several years it had been that the county could avoid environmental liability. But now with the statute changes, the county can also avoid financial. Anything that's going to present a potential risk to the county. That's what these are doing.
Mayor, is there also a possibility of county responsibility for maintaining the property?
Yes, there is. As our chairman faculty can attest to, there is great expense to the county in maintaining these properties. So our preference in all of this is for people to pay the taxes. That's what we really want to come out of this. And then the goal is, if the county
Bourbon Street. Go ahead and cast your vote, lock it in. Madam Clerk, if you'll announce the vote, 24 yes, 0 no, 1 absent, resolution passes. I think it's all for your report, Commissioner Chase.
That is it.
Next out is the Budget Committee. Board, Commissioner Grant.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Please receive our minutes in the August 15th meeting. They're on page 253. And you'll also find an update on the sales tax, most current information on page 266. First resolution for consideration tonight is resolution number 1808 and 22. This is a resolution amending fiscal year 19 budget for renovations to the historic courthouse and the archive space. This represents an updated scope of construction for the archive space and the jail annex, and reauthorizes the funds originally appropriated on resolution number 1802-12. You'll find the plans for this renovation on page 257. Comes to you as a motion for approval.
Motion made by Commissioner Grant, seconded by Commissioner Henson to approve the resolution. Discussion. Commissioner Ford.
These figures, they don't jive with what the our committee. I'm a member of that committee, and they don't jive nowhere close to what we were talking about. Ed, can you give us an input on that? These figures don't jive nowhere near what we talked about in the committee.
They don't. February, County Commission on the 2000 of it. That didn't get bid out before June 30th of the amendment back in the summer. In the meantime, two other items were added to the state work tax budget, which increased by 382,000.
Yeah.
So that's what we did.
So has it been bid out that much? I just think there's a lot of difference in money than what we just talked about.
Well, there were two very large items that were underwritten in the plan. One was proposed to do with the next period. Metal plate, insulated metal plates, and kind of windows in the street. And the other is the roof on the lower roof part where they're going to be looking at the application. So that all jumped the price on the ground. Labor talking about the big expense that we got to have to do it. It has a division.
Is that all coming from your money then?
It is, Mr. Chairman. It's coming from our reserves.
Yes. Further questions?
Question
been called. Madam Clerk, if you'll switch us to the voting screen. Go ahead and cast your vote. Lock it in.
Resolution 1808-24, the resolution authorizing the expenditure for renovation to the historic courthouse exterior, phase one, in amount of $1,100,000. The contractor, Rollison Construction, indicated that the roof work could be done in the fall of 2018, with the remaining work to follow the meeting requested that the Public Records Commission reimburse $100,000, to the Capital Project Fund for the roof that is over the annex, and it represents approximately 50% of the cost of that roof. This resolution comes, to the commission with a motion from the Budget Committee for approval.
Second.
Motion made by Commissioner Grammy, seconded by Commissioner Hodge. Discussion. Question's been called. Madam Clerk, if you'll switch us to the voting screen. Go ahead, cast your vote, lock it in. Yes, two no, one absent, resolution passes.
Next resolution for consideration, resolution 180825. This resolution is authorizing expenditure for the interior renovation of the Washington County Health Department building, not to exceed $443,000. A grant of $400,000 was appropriated fiscal year 2018 budget for special needs and health department building. Additionally, $43,000 was budgeted in the FY19 budget to complete the funding for the project. This resolution is actually authorizing the expenditure of the combined dollars. We've looked at this several times in the past. This resolution comes to the full commission of the Budget Committee for approval.
Second.
Motion made by Commissioner Grandy, seconded by Commissioner Lyon to approve the resolution.
Just a clarification question on this. What was the cost on that?
$443,000 is the total project.
I have one resolution. I have,
Commissioner Grady.
$425,000. That's right. Part of it's already been.
There's already been some architectural fees that I incurred in FY18. So the total, the $434,000.
Okay. Thank you.
Further discussion?
Question.
Question's been called. Madam Clerk, if you'll switch us to the voting screen. Go ahead and cast your vote and lock it in. Absent. Resolution passes.
Next resolution for consideration, resolution 180826, authorizing the purchase of two used vehicles for the property assessor's office that are now not to exceed $45,000. The Hugo Express. This resolution comes to the full commission from the Budget Committee with a motion for approval.
Motion made by Commissioner Grady, seconded by Commissioner Hodge to approve the resolution. Discussion?
Question.
Call. Madam Clerk, if you'll switch us to the voting screen. Go ahead and cast your vote and lock it in. Voting screen. cast your vote, locked in. Madam Clerk, Bill Duff's vote. 24 yes, 0 no, 1 absent. Resolution passes.
Chairman, I have a report.
Thank you, Commissioner Grant. Next item is the notaries. Resolution 180829 is a resolution approving the election of notaries of public for appointment or reappointment to Washington County Council.
Move approval.
Motion made by Commissioner Chase, seconded by Commissioner Boring to approve the resolution. Discussion?
Question.
Questions have been called. Madam Clerk, if you'll switch us to the voting screen. Go ahead and cast your vote, locked in. Madam Clerk, Bill Duff's vote, 24 yes, 0 no, 1 absent. Resolution passes. Next item, we have no new business to discuss. This lady's announcement for the evening is the cutoff date and time for the next month's county commission agenda. It's Friday, September 14th, 5 p.m.
Point of order over here, we have one of our new citizens. Recognition.
Well,
can I introduce my granddaughter?
That's our next mayor.
This is Mayor Elizabeth Green.
Down at the end of this term, I want to thank everyone for our great friendship we've all had. It's been a real pleasure serving and being each day. Some of you, I won't have been so, but.
Carol, I have another motion.
We can do it. We can make one. We can make another motion. She's headed to the podium, Chancellor. She's headed to the podium. All right. Is there any other business we'd like to talk about, discuss, before we depart ways here this evening?
I move adjourn.
Motion adjourned. Thank you, Commissioner Chase. Seconded by Commissioner Baker. All in favor of adjourn, signify by